we'll start.
Oh, and the recording is just right there. Yeah.
Okay, good seeing everybody. And week three, and let's start with a prayer, please. Well, God, we thank you, of course, for who you are, for us, with us, around us, and within us. We thank you for the ways in which we are so obviously blessed. And we thank you for the ways that you bless us that we're not even aware of. We thank you for one another and the gift of your Holy Spirit, who is in this room, who binds us, who in the midst of our best moments and our worst moments, guides us, connects us, and leads us. Lord God, we pray that in a world in which there is tumult, chaos, and sorrow, that your Spirit would come as a comforter, as a peacemaker, and an encourager, one who is on our side and who makes us be on each other's side. So God, on this day, we thank you for all that is and what will come. We thank you that you are with us no matter what. And that God, we bless you right back and wish you a lovely day. We do this in Jesus.
Amen.
Okay. First of all, any questions, concerns, anxieties, amplifications, or repudiations for the last 2 weeks? No. Hallelujah. Okay. This week is Zwingli and the Anabaptists, which I know I said sounds like a 70s rock group, but is a different theological movement. This is, or Zwingli is a statue of him outside the Grossmünster in Zurich, one of my favorite cities. Almost went to school there, but I went north to Marburg instead. And this is an inscription that says in Schweizerdeutsch, in Swiss German, do something brave for God's sake. Now, I don't know if he was saying anything. The tone of voice is really important, isn't it? You know, was he saying, do something brave for God's sake? Or would he be looking at someone like me and go, do something brave for God's sake? So we ask the Spirit would interpret it to your own hearts on this Pentecost day and the way that you need to hear. Recap of the last couple weeks. Okay, remember, we're talking about the Reformation. The Reformation is all Protestants. The Lutherans, who we covered last week. The Reformed, which is us, Presbyterians, Dutch Reformed, German Reformed, the people that got their start in Switzerland as much as, or if not more than, Germany. The Anabaptists, who we'll talk about today, also, which is the Mennonites, and the Amish, and then the Anglicans, the church that started in England when Henry VIII was having a little trouble getting Rome to support him dumping his wife and his second wife and third wife. Four, and then there was Anne of Clavis, and then Catherine Parr.
We don't have all day.
Right. And of course, he blamed all of them, as we men have done before and after the time of the Reformation. So we're talking today about a particular group. Oops. And then the five alones, as it were, of Protestantism. And all Protestants basically support these. Sola Scriptura, Scripture alone. That is our own guide. So it's the only source of authority is Scripture for us, interpreted by the Holy Spirit. Sola Gratia, grace alone. We cannot work our way into heaven. We do good works because we love God and our neighbor, not because God's going to go, hey, look, he's working hard, we'll let him in. That's not. But have you ever read scripture? Starts in Hebrew, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. In fact, that's how I first helped me learn Hebrew for my exam, was reading a Yiddish interpretation of the scripture. Sola fide, faith alone. So we are saved by God's grace because of our faith. Again, not because of our works. Solus Christus, Christ alone. We don't need a priest. We don't need the church for salvation. We need clergy and the church and each other for our Christian lives, but it doesn't save us. And Soli Deo Gloria, which of course Bach wrote at the end of every one of his pieces, which means glory to God alone. We don't glorify the church, we don't glorify the clergy, sorry about that. We love them, we should support them, but the glory goes to God alone. So that's the essence of Protestantism. And as we move into this, remember, as I've said the last 2 weeks, the quote from L.P. Hartley, that the past is a foreign country, they do things differently there. So remember, we're moving into a different era and a different place. And we're also moving out of the Middle Ages. Luther was a man with one foot in the Middle Ages and one in the New World, one in the Renaissance. And in Switzerland, we're pretty much moving out of the Middle Ages. The same turmoil was going on in Switzerland that was going on in the rest of Europe. Rising middle class, resentment of the Catholic Church, what was called the New Thinking, which was one of a return to the sources of things, antiquity, and what we call literary criticism these days. So they looked at the Bible in a very different way, sort of, we could say, a more academic way. But when you do that, it changes how you see it and how you think. So that's going on very powerfully, especially in northern Switzerland, southern Germany, and up in the Netherlands. So it's going on there, particularly in Zurich. So while Luther was Luthering in northern Germany, and the Catholics were staying Catholic in France, Spain, Italy, Bavaria, most of Austria, this different kind of Reformation was happening in northern Switzerland and southwestern Germany. So in looking at Zwingli and then the Anabaptists, we see interpretations of Christianity that are intertwined, but have different ways of seeing it. One, Zwingli, and that would be us, sees Christianity as thoroughly intertwined with the state and with the culture. In fact, the culture shapes us and we shape the culture. The other, the Anabaptists, the Amish, and to some degree the Mennonites, see itself as far apart from the state and the culture as possible. In fact, one of their major things, as we'll see, is separation. Separation from the state, separation from people like us. I mean, not in a hostile way, but just in a, we've sold out. We haven't followed the gospel. They have withdrawn to make the gospel part of their lives. But this, so then this again, as I've been saying, seeing these things happening helps us, and I hope causes us to think about how we see ourselves living out our faith. There are all these different expressions, and each one of them says to us, okay, want to try me? Or what are you doing? If you don't want to do me, what do you want to do? So these things challenge us to think about who we are and how we're living out our faith in the world that we are in.
So quick question.
Joe.
How are you?
I see that hand.
How much, so there's a, there's also a dramatic difference in culture in Europe along the dividing lines between the part of Europe that went along with the Reformation and the part of Europe that stayed Roman Catholic. Did that difference drive the Reformation, or is that difference more of a consequence of that Reformation?
That's a great question. I think to some degree it drove the Reformation.
How so?
Well, where humanism, the new learning, different way of looking at the Bible, and the parts of Europe that went with the Reformation saw themselves as entities in and of themselves. Like, we're Germans, we're Dutch, we're not just parts of this big church that develops all of Western civilization. And so we're, say, German, we're Dutch, we're tired of sending our money over the Alps to Rome and not getting much in return. Just look how corrupt the church is. Plus, we're thinking about things in ways that some other parts of Europe aren't. So that's how it drove the Reformation. It made the soil fertile for two particularly powerful figures, Luther and Zwingli, and then after Zwingli's death, a few years after that, Calvin. So powerful figures stepped into turmoil and resentment, and that drove the Reformation. And then the Reformation just heightened it, of course. The Reformation in Switzerland began with a couple sausages. I'll get back to that later. But that's just sort of one of those things we church historians love to toss out there because it's such a delicious thing to say and eat. When I was in Switzerland 3 weeks ago, we had some of the best sausage. Oh my goodness. Okay, anyway. Yeah, were it not for Christianity, I would just embrace hedonism. So, Zwingli, the reformer of Switzerland, was very different from the Lutheran reformer of Germany. He preceded Calvin by a generation, and through politics, as much as theology, throughout most of northern Switzerland and southern southwestern Germany, into the Reformation. So politics was not just a tool, but was part of it all. Luther was concerned with reforming the church. And if politics played a role in it, and politics were helpful, and politics were changed as a result, terrific. But the church, he wanted to reform the theology of the thinking of the church. Great. Zwingli comes out of what was essentially a democracy. It's still to this day, until fairly recently, you would see in tiles. I have a picture at home of Oppenzell. I was there on a day when they voted. And there were thousands of people packed into the town square to vote. That did not happen in Germany. Germany had princes. Germany had principalities. Switzerland had small democratic states, which then the towns were democratic. They voted. Then the states were democratic. They had representatives from the towns. And then as Switzerland became more of a country, so a little bit set up like we are, very much set up like the Presbyterian Church, which came out of Switzerland through Scotland. So that's what we are. We're a representative democracy, just like Switzerland was. So that just shows again that our environment shapes us. So Zwingli, Ulrich Zwingli, he liked to write it Huldreich Zwingli, because Huldreich means gracious, was born near Zurich, just a few weeks after Luther was born. And as I explained, the Swiss structure was local democracy and a confederation of these local democracies. In fact, if you go to Switzerland, you know everybody has their country sticker. Well, Switzerland has CH, Confederation Helvetica, is the Swiss or the Helvetic Confederation. So it's even part of their the way they describe their country and name their country. His father was a magistrate, so politics was right there in his DNA in the family. So he grew up just assuming the participation in politics, participation in the social structure, and maintaining social cohesion were basic elements of life. You participated in it. You were part of it. You weren't commanded by a prince. You participated in creating the government. So in other words, he grew up in this place that he just didn't think differently. He had what in psychoanalysis we call unconscious invariant organizing principles. We all have them. You know, if you grew up in a family where everybody was grumpy, then you just go into the world without even thinking about it, expecting people to be grumpy. So somebody who grows up in a more supportive, happy family, without even thinking about it, they go into the world sort of expecting people to be nice. So and the grumpy, so again, they would hear what Zwingli said earlier in two different ways. The grumpy family would hear person without even thinking about it, would just read that and go, do something brave for God's sake. And the person coming up with the nice family without even thinking about it would hear Zwingli going, do something brave for God's sake. So Luther grows up with princes, doesn't even occur to him. That's why they have bishops. Zwingli grows up in a democracy, doesn't even occur to him that anything would be different. So his churches and we end up assuming we should participate in things. We have sessions. We have a session that responds to the people. So Zwingli's growing up in this sort of atmosphere. But it also challenges us then to ask, what's driving me? What do I automatically think? What's going on in me that I'm not even aware of? And that's partly why we need each other so much, so that we can point things out and see things differently and help each other sort of sometimes break, sometimes affirm and confirm the ways we're thinking. So Zwingli grows up, they say, oh, we have a bright son. He goes off to spend time with his uncle, who is a priest, who teaches him Latin and Greek. So this little boy, this is, and remember again, this is the new learning the ancient languages so that we can understand the Bible better. We don't just have to listen to what the priest, who might not even be well educated, tells us the Bible is saying. We can now do literary criticism. Oh, this isn't just God talking. This is God talking through, this is poetry here. Oh, this is instruction here. Oh, look at this. The Apostle Paul has inserted a hymn in Galatians. I'm a Presbyterian, so I like the Book of Order better than the Bible. So that's what's going on. It's just a different way of thinking, and it changes your mind. Notice that all the leaders of the Reformation were people who did two things. They got as educated as they could. Even the simple people of the Amish, that started with people who were priests and monks and were university educated. So they all took education seriously, and they all took the Bible very seriously, studied very seriously. He was ordained in 1506 after going to Vienna and the University of Basel. where Erasmus was, the new thinking, the hero of new thought, who was provocative with the Catholic Church. Got ordained, went off to Glarus, and he was a chaplain for Swiss mercenaries. If you've ever been to Switzerland, you know it's a rugged country. So it does not support a huge population. So they had banking that supported the entire world. People know what I mean. But it's not conducive to like a lot of farming and everything. It's mountains and it's rocky. So a lot of Swiss men were mercenaries, especially for the Pope, in various wars against people. He went off as a chaplain, saw 6,000 young Swiss men get slaughtered in a battle. Went back to Switzerland and said, this ain't right. Oh, he said it in Swiss German, so he couldn't understand his bad grammar. But he went back, he said, this ain't right. So he starts criticizing using Swiss men as mercenaries, which of course angered the Pope. Again, he studied Greek, he memorized the New Testament. He met Erasmus of Rotterdam, who had a great influence on him, who had that Bible in Latin, which everybody knew, and Greek, which not a lot of people knew. So again, the reformers are touched by seeing the Bible in a new light. He thought that looking at scripture, he thought that Christ alone shows us how we are to fulfill God's will. Very Christ-centered. What's he saying? What's he doing? And what do I need to do? Because remember, he comes from a participatory world. So it's not just, oh, this is what Jesus said. It's, okay, this is what Jesus said and did, and he's telling me to do too in the world. So it's very activist in a way. And he thought that the Sermon on the Mount contains the ethical laws of God. If you want to live like a Christian, you read, believe, and follow the Sermon on the Mount. Do that, and you don't have to worry about what not to do, because if you're doing the right thing, you won't be doing the wrong thing. So very Christocentric. Then he went to Einsiedeln, which was a gorgeous town, to be the priest at a monastery. And he noticed pilgrims coming. Because remember, a couple weeks ago, we talked about how you can please God and get indulgences for buying. Everybody here got an indulgence. And but we haven't seen the cash rolling. You remember this, it says as soon as the coin and the copper rings they stole from Purgatory Springs, haven't heard the coffers ringing, so you're still stuck where you are. Just a reminder. So anyway, enough of that. So he said, these poor people are coming on pilgrimages. They shouldn't be doing. They need to be home working. They need to be home loving their families. They need to be home changing the way they live. So he starts attacking that in his sermons and his writings. Then he goes after the sale of indulgences, just like Luther was doing. Although he went on not on theological grounds, but because they were disruptive of the fabric of the society of the church. You get how important society and connections are to him. And typically that's been true of the essence of the Presbyterian Church. It's connections with each other. 1518, although he started on his birthday in 1519, he was called to the Grossmünster in Zurich as what's called the Leutprediger, or the people's priest, where he would begin and remain until his death. He was killed in 1531. Primary tasks were pastoral care and preaching, at which he was very good. And he began to slowly pull away from the teachings of the Roman Catholic Church. And then it really got rolling, because when he got there, he did something that priests virtually never did. It started with Matthew and preached all the way through it. Normally, you had a, it's called the lectionary. You have a particular scripture passage for each Sunday, but he didn't do that. He just started with Matthew, preached all the way through Matthew, then went all the way through Acts, and then went through the Old Testament. Then he began to criticize the idea of purgatory and monasticism and praying to the saints. So this doesn't sound very Roman Catholic anymore. Oh, this little guy down, I don't know why I'm pointing, you can't see it, see me pointing. This little guy down here is Charlemagne, Charles the Great, who allegedly founded the Grossmünster in 800. So they have that little statue of him down in the basement of the church. 1519, the bubonic plague swept through Zurich. Let's see, what do I have next? That was Einsiedel. During the bubonic plague, swept through, this was the later bubonic plague, by the way. There were series of them. It swept through Zurich, and whereas a lot of other clergy got out of town, he stayed there, he ministered, he got the plague himself. But he ministered to people, and of course, this made him sort of like a local hero. You know, it's like sort of like the people who rush into the situation where people need to be rescued. We think, wow, we kind of think highly of them for doing that. So that made him, not only is he a great preacher and a great statesman, but now he's a great personal hero. He wrote a really interesting hymn about plague and how God got him through it after he got quite ill. By 1526, radical changes were sweeping all through northern Switzerland. The Anabaptist movement was underway and spreading. So now we have those people with beards and hats, which I'll explain in just a little bit. In 1531, the Roman, and it probably provoked it actually, the Roman Catholic cantons, the Roman Catholic states, south and east, attacked Zurich. Zurich was not quite ready for it. They went out to defend themselves. He goes out as part of the force, gets wounded, gets captured, and gets killed. Supposedly, his last words, again, supposedly, were they can kill the body but not the soul, which would be very Zwingli. Luther, who didn't like Zwingli, claimed that Zwingli just got what he deserved, because a clergyman should never go into battle. And the Roman Catholics then took his body and burned him as a heretic. So that's Zwingli.
Why didn't Luther like Zwingli?
Because what's so interesting is that in 1528 or 1529, Zwingli and Luther met in Marburg in the castle there. So Philip of Hessen was trying to create a unified Protestantism, and they agreed on 14 issues. When they got to communion, it all fell apart. Lutherans, whether they know it or not, to this day believe that Christ is in, with, and under the elements. So it's sort of like a semi-Catholic thing, and called consubstantiation. Zwingli said, no, it's simply a memorial. And because Luther thought that Christ was actually present and therefore played a role in your ongoing salvation, the communion is critical. Zwingli said, no, it's a memorial. Christ is there, but that's because Christ, in a sense, chooses to be there. He doesn't have to show up when he didn't want to. And Luther didn't like that, and so the whole thing fell apart. And he said, Zwingli, I'll shake hands with you, but not as a Christian brother. Yeah, well, strong personalities in the same room, get two alpha males in the same room, and that's what happens. So Zwingli, as I said, was influenced by Erasmus, which means he changed his way of thinking. He thought about the Bible a lot more like we do. Parts of it are literal, parts of it are metaphor. But again, here's, I like this. It's just a little ego trip for him. He said, I began to preach the gospel in 1516 before men had even heard of Luther. So take that. And remember that Luther did his 95 theses in 1517. So Zwingli's claiming priority here. He also said, because when people said, oh, well, you're being a reformer type, you must be a Lutheran. He said, call me a Paulist, not a Lutheran. And 1520, he even breaks with Erasmus. Erasmus sort of stuck with the Roman Catholic Church. Zwingli said people need salvation more than they need to be enlightened by the new learning. Now, he never rejected this approach to scripture. But he said there has to be more to it. And so just to switch, just to show the differences with Luther, who was reforming the rest of the world, he's more humanistic. Remember when Erasmus was told that he laid the egg that hatched Luther, Erasmus said, yes, but I expected quite a different bird. He would have been very happy with Zwingli. Somebody had said that about Zwingli. He wanted to change the whole system and ethics and society, not simply theology. Luther wasn't interested in changing theology or society. He was interested in changing the theology and what the church meant. The Lord's Supper is commemorative. Christ is not truly present in the elements. And then in the adiaphora, which means things indifferent, things that aren't essential, like whether you have a glass of wine or don't have a glass of wine, whether you wear a sport coat that's wool or whether you wear a sport coat that's made of silk. These are what goes on in the decoration of the church. And of course, we all know everybody fights over what goes on in the decoration of churches. But those are not essential to our salvation, although people act like it. So this is typical of us, of the Reformed, things are more simple. So for worship in a Lutheran church, anything that the Bible does not forbid, you can do. That's why there's stained glass, that's why there's organs, that's why there's continued the Roman Catholic look. You go to some Lutheran churches, a traditional Lutheran church, were sat through the service, you could imagine it was Catholic. It looks exactly Catholic, although they believe they're doing something very, very different is going on. But it looks the same. You go to most Presbyterian churches, they're not really old, and downtown churches, and they're much simpler. They have little or no stained glass, or stained glass is simple. The clergy, if they wear robes, wear academic robes, just a simple black robe and a stole. You almost never see Presbyterian clergy with a chasuble and an alb and this and that and all that sort of thing. So for Lutherans, what the Bible strictly says don't do, you can go ahead and do. For Reform, like us, we've changed a lot over the years. For the Reform, you can only do what the Bible prescribes. So if the Bible doesn't say do it, you shouldn't do it. Now, unfortunately, what that meant in that particular moment, and happily people got over it, was what's called iconoclasm. People in Zurich and some of the other towns that followed Zwingli went into their churches, they took out the organs or nailed them shut. Some of them broke stained glass windows, fortunately many of them didn't, but a lot of them took out statues. Oh, again, I'm pointing at the screen. Statues and burned them in the public square. So that's not great. Zwingli was primarily a preacher, believed that the Bible was really very clear if you just actually studied it. Now, his practical reforms are that Zurich was the first church organized on a Protestant understanding of Scripture. Remember, everything in Lutheran territory is pretty much remained the same. Zwingli tried to say, okay, this is what a New Testament church should look like. So this is what we're going to do. And that's why we worship the way that we do. The Bible is the guide to every single doctrinal and church. Secular governments were involved in enforcing church law. Because remember, again, and there's a debate, did Zwingli create a theocracy or not? And people still are trying to do it in various countries, in some ways, including our own. He rejects mercenary services. If you've been to Rome, you've seen the Swiss Guard. I mean, in essence, they're still Swiss mercenaries. But he rejected that, which meant a break with the Roman Catholic Church. And then in 1522, two significant shifts happened. This is where we say the Reformation in Switzerland began with a couple sausages on one of the Lenten Fridays when you were supposed to fast. And remember, Catholics, devout Catholics to this day, still eat fish on Fridays. They don't eat meat. Well, this is 500 years ago. Some people went out to the public square, had a little barbecue, roasted some sausages. And Zwingli was there, and he thought this was a terrific idea. But this is a violation of a fundamental orientation. And all theological hell broke loose. And that year, he also gets married. Now, he had been secretly married for 2 years. And they just went out and had a public wedding. It was not rare. There were two kinds of marriages. Some priests were just horny and were violating their laws of celibacy. Other priests actually just had what looked like a genuine marriage. And half the town knew it. And they approved because they thought it was bizarre that people couldn't marry. So this was going on throughout Europe. He gets married publicly, and all of a sudden, priests and nuns are marrying like crazy all over northern Switzerland and parts of Germany. I mean, Zwingli did it, looks good, didn't get executed. Pope was a little pissed, but who cares about Pope? Because we're in the middle of the Reformation. Sweet. So they get married. Their marriages are all over the place. So the city council then says, okay, wait a minute, things are getting out of hand. Zwingli, what the heck's going on? Zwingli writes his 67 theses, outdoing Luther by a whole lot with his mere 95, in which he goes to the council and rethinks, as Luther did, the sacraments. They're no longer the seven sacraments. They're only two, just like we have. He rejects infant baptism, which is a heck of a thing to reject. And again, the Lord's Supper now is no longer called the Mass. It's called communion or the breaking of the bread, and it's simply commemorative. And preaching moves to the center. You'll see a lot of Reformed churches from that time, especially if you go to the Netherlands, and the pulpit will be very high and will be dead center in the church. And there won't be an altar, there will be a communion table. And because how do you get saved? How do you get the word of God? You get it through preaching. You don't get Jesus through communion, you get Jesus through hearing the word of God explained to you. So for him, they only had communion four times a year. We have it once a month, pretty much on the first Monday. So things changed dramatically under him. He also was responsible for what we now have as the deacons. That the church, connected with the state, was responsible in caring for the poor. So we think that comes from Geneva, but it actually comes from Zurich. That there is a conscious effort for the church to be deliberately involved in the lives of the sick and the poor. And that's with many of you, those of you who are deacons, in some ways you're still there to do that. You really are helpers. So, and again, he patterned in the church after his Swiss democracy, which looks a lot like the American democracy, which looks a lot like the way we are figured as well. Lutherans have bishops, because that's where princes were. We have sessions, because that's where Zwingli was, and later Calvin adopted that. 1525, he reaffirms infant baptism, which drove the more radical thinkers crazy. Because nowhere in the Bible do you find infant baptism. I mean, some people say, well, so-and-so and his whole household were baptized. The whole household, you know, probably included some kids. But there's nothing definitive about that. But, so he rejected it on those grounds. But now he goes back to affirming infant baptism. And all the radicals who were following him said, well, then, the heck with you. We're going to start our own stuff. But we'll get to them in a minute. They're the Anabaptists. Anabaptist means rebaptizer. He's declared a heretic. A number of the cantons, the states, formally leave the Roman Catholic Church. So his influence, he launched the Anabaptist movement. Without him, we wouldn't have Mennonites and Amish and all that sort of thing. He brought Reformed thought, mainly through Calvin, all over northern Switzerland, up the Rhine, and into the Netherlands. And which then, of course, influenced John Knox, who then started Presbyterian Church back here in Scotland. And here we are, a bunch of Presbyterians. And he also helped get the Puritan movement started through his friend Martin Bucer, who was in Strasbourg and then went to England, and the people who were being persecuted under Queen Mary, who came to Zurich, began to look like Zwingli, took it back, and then we got the Puritan. So questions, concerns, anxieties.
How did the Huguenots fit into this?
Yes, they were French Calvinists, and they didn't fit into this particular movement yet, because they were more influenced by Calvin, who was just a little bit later. But Calvin, who was much like Zwingli, but a little more relaxed. And a little more open spiritually to what's going on in the world. Calvin and other French reformers what he became Swiss, but were very active in France. And that's so that the Huguenots started a little bit later than this. That makes sense. I see that hand. I love it. I see that hand.
Do you notice, because you apparently, you know, travel back and forth, do you notice a big difference or differences between American Presbyterianism and European Presbyterianism?
For one thing, the Presbyterians there, the Reformed, tend to be more traditional than we are. But we actually go to church and they don't.
All right.
And church attendance over there is way down, but they're much more traditional than we, in the ways that they worship. So except for a few churches, if you were to go to a Reformed church over there, it would look look much more like it was 100, 200 years ago, maybe with some updated music and all that sort of thing. Everything gets a little bit more modern, but it's not as easygoing as it is over here. And they don't have quite the scope that we do. I mean, because remember, we also have several different Presbyterian churches. Some don't ordain women, some do, hallelujah, that sort of thing. Okay, in that case then, we will go on to the Anabaptist movement. What happened was when Zwingli said, okay, I no longer only support believers' baptism, I'm going back to infant baptism, this group that said, wait a minute, we're taking the Bible seriously, you can't find it there, fine. We're going to be real Christians if you're just going to be, you know, a puppet of the state, and make the state do what you want, and baptize infants, which is not in scripture. So we will start our own group. But they didn't think of themselves as rebaptizers, because everybody here who was baptized as an infant was never really baptized, because it's not true baptism. So they just thought they were baptizers. Everybody else called them rebaptizers, and rebaptizing was a capital offense.
Capital offense.
Wow. Yeah. But now for the most important question regarding theology, the most important question that affects us all and we all wonder about is, why do almost all the men have those beards? Male Amish who are unmarried are either clean shaven or more likely have a little tiny beard, while married men let their beards grow long. So why do they all have beards? Because they're mentioned so frequently in the Bible. That's why. Psalm 133 says, how good and pleasant it is when brothers live together in unity like the precious oil poured on the head, running down on the beard. Leviticus 19, you must not cut off the hair at the sides of your head. That's why we see real Orthodox Jews like that. Or clip the edges of your beard. So everybody in the Bible wore beards, and it even talks directly about beards. So some of you may want to rethink your salvation. Just say it. It also is just Amish men don't wear wedding rings. So a long beard is a symbol of being married and your commitment. It is like having your wedding ring on your chin. Except that, you know, it collects crumbs. Your wedding ring doesn't do anything unless it's really cheap. Makes your finger green. Okay.
So do women wear them?
No. Okay. They don't do jewelry.
Oh, that's right.
And so then the question is, okay, why don't they wear mustaches? Because they are pacifists. So they prefer to be called non-resistant, actually. But because they're pacifists, and in the early days of the movement, elaborate mustaches were worn by military men. If you look at pictures, almost up to World War I, when they had to wear gas masks, lots of military men and especially officers had these terrific mustaches. It was almost like part of their uniform. And being pacifistic, they wanted to completely disassociate themselves from the military. So that's why they have long beards. So there's the most critical issue about Anabaptism, and we're done today. Or don't you wish? So what happened was, with this new freedom that everybody has now, and this is, again, this is where not having clergy can get a little dangerous. Not having somebody who actually knows what the Bible is trying to tell you and just assuming you can interpret it any way you like can get us into a little bit of trouble. There were a couple different movements. We're going to focus on the ones that lasted and the most familiar to us. But there was a violent Anabaptist movement. People who, you know what they would be like? They would be like theological Proud Boys who want to take over things. And they took over the city of Munster, and in a one moment of glorious, glorious ecumenism, the Catholics and the other Protestants joined together to slaughter them. So if you go to the city of Munster, go to St. Laurent's Church, and you'll still see those cages where the ringleaders of taking over an entire city and making it a mini theocracy with their own theology were killed, were hung in these cages, and just were eaten by the birds or whatever else. And it's still there to this day. It's one of the few things you can see without paying admission for. But the group, and I'll try to do this relatively quickly, the group that we're thinking of, that we're most familiar with, the Mennonites and the Amish. As I said, when Zwingli said, no, we're going to baptize infants again, after all, saying, well, look, there was circumcision, which is an analogy to this, that really has to do with joining the community, has nothing to do with your salvation. So it's important from childhood. They said, fine. Several of them, Felix Mans, Conrad Grebel, went down to the Niemot River. One of them baptized himself, then baptized everybody else. And then they began preaching this sort of even more radical gospel in this more radical way of living, which again challenges me. You know, when I got up this morning, I had a bunch of sport coats that I could have spent the money on a bunch of those sport coats, giving it to the church to support their food program and stuff. I could live a lot simpler than I do, except for why. That's a tradition. So again, it's a challenge to us to live a little bit like they do. They broke away and started doing all this thing. And as I said, rebaptizing was a crime. So they were thrown in prison. They were beheaded. These are the gentle people. These are the non-resistant type. Here's a woodcut from that time of Felix Mans being drowned. It was like a cruel parody. They would say, fine, now you're baptized once and for all. And yeah, it was very, very awful. Mans was arrested in prison several times, either escaped or was let go. Then finally, they drowned him. The movement spread, and it spread to a Benedictine monk called Michael Sattler, who I believe is no reference. Now, he is from the area where my grandfather came, but I think there's no connection between us, although it would be really cool. But then I feel like I had to become an Anabaptist. I don't want to do that. But he was reading Zwingli stuff. He was reading scripture in the new way, thought about what the Apostle Paul was saying, and he left the monastery. Went to Zurich, went to Strasbourg, which was a hotbed of theological disputes, and became a leader in the Anabaptist movement, which his thinking was consolidated in the Schleitheim article. We'll rush through them. He got arrested. Here's what the judge said. Michael Sattler shall be committed to the executioner. The latter shall take him to the square, there first cut out his tongue.
Oh,
you cut out a tongue because a heretic has slandered God with the tongue, and because that way they can't preach on the way to their death.
Oh,
because they used to preach on the way to their death. Well, you can't do that without a tongue. So then forge him to a wagon, tear pieces from his body with glowing tongs. Then again on the way to the site of the execution, then burn his body to powder as an arch heretic. Then the next day they burn his wife.
Oh.
I don't know, the next day they drowned. They drowned his wife.
Oh.
But this is what he wrote, and we'll rush through them. This is the essence of Anabaptism. In the Schleitheim articles, which is a fun word to say, Schleitheim, and sort of encapsulate, if you want to know what they believe, even the Mennonites believe this, not this codified, but this is essentially what they believe, although they tend to live in the world a little bit differently than the Amish, of course. Baptism is for believers only. There's the band, you shut, everybody here see the movie The Witness? You know, and he said, the father said, stay away from the Englishman, otherwise we won't even be able to talk to you. So anybody that persists in sin is shunned by the community. They can still live in the community, but nobody will talk to them, have anything to do with them until they repent and give up. The Lord's Supper is simply a remembrance, bare bones. We do it to remember Christ. Nothing mystical happens as happens in St. Luther or in Calvin. Separation from all things and people who are still worldly. That's why some Amish will go and you'll say, well, wait a minute, they have lights on in their house. They're using a generator. But they won't be connected to the power grid because then that's a connection with the rest of the world, even through a wire. So separate themselves from people like us who are too worldly. Pastors are shepherds. They aren't ordained. They're selected by the community. But they are there to lead the community, to admonish, to discipline, to read scripture, to break the bread, to care for people. Just sort of like the pastors do here. It's very much that role, except the Presbyterianism, we're ordained, and they ain't. The sword, in other words, that's violence. Secular authorities can use violence, imprisonment, etc., to protect the good from people who are evil. But Christians may not use violence for any reason. If a genuine, actual, deep, thoroughgoing Anabaptist, if somebody came in here and began to shoot, they would still not use violence against that person. I mean, most of us would be crazy. I mean, you know, they just wouldn't do it. Christ didn't do it. Christ told Peter not to do it. Christ could have called down 10,000 angels and subdued his enemies, but he didn't do it. He went to the cross, so did the disciples. Or so the disciples, yeah.
How did they manage people in their society who are violent? Like, what do they do with those people?
Well, first of all, it's very rare that they are. But there is still a lot of spouse abuse in that community. So if they choose to act on it, they shun them. They essentially shame them for changing their ways. Also, people who are more likely to embrace violence and the things that tend to go with it, like drug use and all that sort of stuff, tend to leave the community. All kids who want to do a thing with alcohol, then do a thing called umspringen. So when they're around 16 years of age, they want to, they leave. They go out in the world, and they try living in the world, seeing what it's like. If they like it, they stay. If they don't like it, they come back to the community. And the final thing then is, the oath. You cannot swear an oath. You don't swear on the Bible. You don't swear by, as it did in scripture, you don't swear by somebody's beard or anything like that. Let your yes, as Jesus said, let your yes be yes and your no be no. This also permeates what the Mennonites think. But there are different groups. There's in their simplicity, there are black bumper Mennonites. Mennonites who can drive a car, but they paint everything black, all that sort of thing. But the Amish still, to this day, live as they did 500 years ago. The thing on the left is a songbook written in the 1500s. The one on the right is the exact same songbook printed up in 2002. So finally, the final challenge is, how do we live our lives as Christians in this world? Do we separate from something? What do we do? And the final one is, why don't men have beards? Because Adam, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, David, the prophets, Jesus himself wore the beard, but you're not. Way to be biblical. So that, any last second questions? I see that hand. Yes.
So is the taking a sabbatical when you're 16 kind of part of the culture, or is it just they just decided to do it, or is it that you need?
It's part of the culture.
So they just over time it happened.
Yes. If the kids want to try, and many of them do, they want to try something different, and they either stay out or they come back. It's just what they do.
You know the percentage?
I don't. Okay, God bless you. Your hand?
Yes. Dick Fern texted, Zwingli called himself a Paulist. Was he, or did he have his foundation in the gospel?
Good question. He probably more had his foundation in the gospel. But he organized the church around the way Paul talks in the particular, especially Corinthians, the various Corinthian churches. Okay, yes.
I have loved this presentation. I'm sorry I missed the 1 week, but I'm actually trying to do a commercial interruption here. We're doing a blood drive in Fellowship Hall, and we've had some cancellations today because some